All right, welcome to our video. We're doing our best here, running into technical difficulties, and the world may be running into some difficulties coming up pretty soon, but we want to have, our goal is to have, be prepared, spiritually prepared, actually, spiritually prepared for whatever happens. Let whatever happen, happen. We'll be spiritually prepared. And what I'm finding out by testing this out is to have a simple assertion you can make to yourself in your mind that frees you up from all the chaos going on in your mind. I've been testing this out and it's working. It is working. And it is truly the most interesting situation I've ever come across in my life, is to see how you're able to just sail past this turmoil. And you're able to detach from it no matter what. It's incredible. Well, not incredible. It is super credible. I mean, it's a wow is what it is. So there's a lot of wow going on by using this. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Just that simple. 1, 2, 3. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I haven't changed in the slightest bit. All right. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. What I do is no matter what comes up mentally, just say, oh, revert to the practice. I am not a body. I am free, and just keep saying it. And the mental construct that was trying to grab hold of my attention, my energy, just falls to the ground. You just fly right past it like you're flying through the clouds. You see all these menacing clouds and you just keep flying. And you realize, oh, I'm going right through the cloud. Yeah, it's not stopping me at all. This is amazing. And the variety of ways in which the mind tries to waylay us is truly astonishing. And even more astonishing is how easy it is to just sail right past them. I was like, what? And you can see these entanglements. You say, oh my gosh, this thing has entangled me my whole life. And you just keep saying, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Right? And before you know it, that massive entanglement is you don't even remember it. It's gone. You didn't do anything to it. You just kept on flying. You just kept flying. It's like a cloud that puts on a menacing aspect to it. Wow. And then you think it's like concrete or something, and you just fly right through it. You know, it doesn't stop you at all. And so the mind, you see the mind and the tricks it plays. Oh my gosh. And the same old tricks that have worked before, it brings those back up and says, hey, great. Now that you're able to practice, I want you to get working on this other project. Well, that only cost me like 15 years of delay, you know, beforehand when I was afraid to practice. I said, maybe I practice too difficult. Oh, well, here's something you can occupy your time with. Oh, yeah. And so once again, here I'm practicing, and then something in my mind says, hey, you're really good at this. I think you've got it. Okay, now, here's this. I got this really wonderful project for you to do. I say, hey, wait a minute. That's the same project that you had me try to do 15 years ago. I wasted 15 years of my life, so to speak. Not entirely wasted because he tried to make, lemonade out of lemons. But, and it tried to hook me into the same exact trick that it used before. I was like, wow, you know that didn't work. You know that that is absolutely wrong. We spent, 15 years realizing how wrong that was, and yet you want me to jump right back into it. I said, that is very amazing, isn't it? And I just said, no, I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And don't explain that at all. Don't explain it. Ask yourself this. When you're flying a plane through the clouds, do you need to explain to the clouds how it is that you're able to fly the plane through the clouds? Are the clouds saying, hey, you can't come through here. What are you? What is this? How are you doing this? You need to explain to us. No, you just keep on flying, and you realize the clouds can't stop you at all. But they try to be very bullying and demanding, the clouds, knowing that there's no substance to them, right? So it's all front. It's all front. It's all a bluff. Clouds are a bluff. Just keep flying. Just say, hey, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Powerful, powerful. Now, the ego will say, well, yeah, but there's some other ones that are better, or how do you know that's the best, and try to get you in this comparison, waste time comparison. Just say, you know what? It's good enough. It's really good. I know it's really good. It's like the ego saying, hey, that's not the best plane there is. I think there might even be a better plane, or I, you know, hey, there's lots of different types of planes, right? As long as they fly really well, they can go right through clouds. So what are the clouds saying? You know, hey, maybe you know, is that not the best plane, so you can't fly through the clouds? You know, crazy stuff like that. But this is, as far as my life and looking at the overall spiritual terrain of this planet, this is as good an assertion as there is. Okay, if there's a million other ones that are just as good, fine, but this is right up there in the top echelon of assertions. In other words, this plane flies, and that's all you need to know, is this plane flies. Don't get into the ego saying, well, does it do loop to loop, and how fast, and is it, maybe there's a plane that goes 10 miles an hour faster, so you need to think maybe that your plane's supposed to drop from the sky then, or can't go through clouds. This is the trickery that the ego uses on you, saying, well, there's some other plane that flies 10 miles an hour faster, therefore that can fly through clouds, but your plane will hit the cloud like concrete and disintegrate or something. And you just say, you know, that's absurd. Utterly absurd. The ego is utterly absurd. The belief in time is actually utterly absurd. And this is what we're defending. Okay, we're defending time. What the ego does is defend time. What we're doing is we're saying, whoa, 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 slow down, slow down, slow down. We need time. We need time to get well. We need time. Time has to be the one who eventually cures us. Why are we saying this? Okay, this is crucial. This is very crucial. Because we think time is the one that has caused the problems. Okay, and we know deep down that the cause and effects are really inseparable, even though we try to separate them. But we believe that time is a force greater than us that has imposed bodies and worlds and process and space and time, has imposed this upon us, forced this upon us. And so we have to propitiate time and work with time and find some way to convince time to free us from this prison that we think that time has put us in. And so we say, no. If we don't have time to free us from this prison, we'll never get free. You know, if you kill time, we'll never know how to get free of this prison. Only time knows how to do this. Well, so we protect time. The ego protects the belief in time by saying, no. This isn't good enough. You got to find something better. So you'll spend your whole life thinking, well, this is good, but I need to find something better because this isn't good enough. Because that's what the ego is saying. It's not good enough. Delay, 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 delay. I mean, I could have said this, you know, 50 years ago and saved myself 50 years of torment. But the trickery of time, it gets us all, doesn't it? Pretty much gets us all. And so we just have to realize that, yeah, we've been fooled by time and we're not the only ones. And let me see if I can adjust this. We take a little break. It's not coming up. Okay, well, I'll just have to put up with it the way it is. It's that simple. Maybe this one will do it. Okay. So, changing lighting conditions constantly here outdoors. The sun is setting here. Another beautiful California day. So, time is the key focus, really. And let's talk a little bit about time. But before we do that, let us realize that if we saw that we can get rid of, that we can drop our belief in time, we realize there's never been any time. Nothing's imposed, nothing outside of us has ever imposed anything upon us. Then we'll say, well, wait a minute, I feel like I'm this body, I'm in a world, I'm all this stuff, how do I get free of that? And then we get all nervous. But if you have this type of practice, If you have this one assertion you can use, like a plane, like flying a plane, and you realize you can fly past all of those mental entanglements, and they cannot touch you, you can fly that plane up to where there are no mental entanglements at all. Because everything is just a belief in the mind, okay? There's nothing binding the mind at all, okay? There's nothing truly binding the mind at all. So if you do have, if you're proficient with this and you realize, hey, I got this always and I can use this always, then you're not afraid to see that there is no agency of time whatsoever. There's no nothing outside the mind we call time that can bind it at all. But if you don't have this practice in your back pocket, you know you can do it constantly and you know you can get through anything, then of course you're going to break out in a cold sweat of terrible fear and the feeling that you're trapped. So this is why historically all teachers have urged those who seek advice and counsel to practice, get better and better and better at practicing. This is why. Now, what we will add here is to say that why are we believing in time in the first place? And it's because we're trying to trick God. We're trying to say, hey God, but wait, first of all, why are we trying to trick God? We want to be greater than God. But since we realize that God is absolute freedom, the spontaneity that is always all that is, that you can't get better than, bigger than that. You cannot. So we said, you know, there's one way. Let's make God smaller. Let's make God less, so that we can then say, okay, we're everything. God, you're less than everything. Okay, so we imagine this outside agency we call time binding our minds, and then we say, hey God, you didn't know this, but actually you're not the greatest. There's this force called time that's bound us, and since we're an extension of you, we are God, that means that you're bound too, and you need to come here and dwell in time with us, you see. And then we started worshiping this God of time as if it were the true God, and just pretending that we have managed to, you know, lower God down into time, which is like an imprisonment, okay? And then we feel like that, hey, we've succeeded in making God less than what God is. And then therefore, since we did that, we must be greater. We must have some power to do that. This is what's behind this craziness that we've been involved in. So we want to be able to realize, you know, that time has never existed. Time has never existed. So when we say, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me, we are asserting that God is not trapped in time at all. We are still exactly the same as God created us, which means we were created no time at all. There's no time. We're absolutely free. So we're saying, yeah, we're still exactly the way that God created us. We're not entrapped in time. We're not a form. We're not body. We're absolutely free. So it's repenting. It's saying, hey, God, we know you're not a God of time. We know you're a God that created me, that created me. I'm still exactly the way you created me. So you're a God of eternal creation that is not untouched by anything whatsoever. You cannot be dragged down into an imaginary realm called time, because it doesn't exist. It exists in our imagination only, and we're pretending to be bound and influenced and acted upon by this force we call time, space, process, and form, when in fact all it is we're pretending. It's super pretension, for sure. It's such a massive and complex pretension that it seems incredibly realistic and plausible, but it is a pretension nonetheless. We are still absolutely free. There isn't any such thing as time at all. We can choose this very instant. We can choose any experience we want to. It all is free, completely free, always, even now, this instant, every instant. In spite of the fact that we think we're encased in this prison called the universe of all these laws and forces and nature and all this stuff, this is 100% pretension on our part, on the part of mind. This is how creative mind can be. Mind is all creative. So it can dream up a pretend scenario, such as the universe. and pretend that this is their home. And then they say, well, since God created me, then this must be God's home too. And then believe that God is a God of this universe, of this world, of bodies, you know, and thereby say, oh, we managed to lower God down and make God less. You know, this is the game we're playing. The thing is, God isn't playing that game at all. Because there isn't anywhere for everywhere to go. There isn't any higher. There isn't any lower. There isn't any lack of freedom. There isn't any time or space, process, or form at all, actually. This is just a fantasy in the mind. It's just a fantasy. And God knows it's just a fantasy. So God has not been lowered down at all. Therefore, God is not upset with us, not angry with us. There's no sacrifice needs to take place. Nothing. Everything's fine. Everything's perfect. Everything's fine. And we can recognize this, but there's like a fear lock that we have. And we say, oh gosh, if I recognize there's no time, then how can time ever help me get free of what it did to me, you know? And we think that we need to give time, forgive time, say, oh, okay, time, I forgive you for doing this to me. Would you please, you know, take all this affliction off of me? You know, it's like we're talking to what doesn't exist and claiming that it did all this stuff to us. So in looking at this fear lock, I can see it. I've been glimpsing it now. I just say, oh, yeah, I see it. You know, there's no such thing as time. But I realize everyone else is going to say, oh, yes, there is. Yes, there is. At least there's some. I need some to help me out because I know at least partially what I'm struggling with is what time did to me. You know, something did something to me. And, you know, they've got to undo it. You know, if I just, maybe I forgive them, they'll undo it. Okay, I forgive you, time, for causing me death and suffering. Would you please undo it for me now, you know? We need to forgive ourselves for trying to lower God down and make God less than what God is. And forgive ourselves for pretending and imagining that there's some sort of force that can bind us. What God created, cannot be bound, cannot be made unfree. So we need to forgive ourselves for this terrible fantasy that we've suffered from, really, because we keep pretending that we're bound. You know, we're bound by nature. We're bound by time, process. You know, in order to do something, it takes time. It takes process. It's not true. It's not true at all. Mind is not bound by anything. Whatever mind imagines, wants to experience, that's concurrently, that's what is. That's what is. It already is. In fact, everything already is, actually, because it's all pure potentiality. In that pure potentiality, we call God the pure spaciousness, pure potentiality. Everything already is. All already is. I am already that. I am already that. Not just I am that. I am already that. Okay. I am already that. To add on to the famous book, I Am That, I would say, even better, say, I am already that. I am already that. Everything is already everything, actually. Because everything is one with pure potentiality, absolute pure potentiality. Anyway, that's beyond what we can even imagine. But the importance of having a practice that you can go to under all sorts of stressful conditions. So I'm practicing this and going about my day and days under all circumstances. I'm trying to remember to say this. Now, there's some circumstances where I blank out and don't say it, especially when I'm dealing like with cashiers or talking business or something, you know, dealing with work or something. You tend to like, oh, I can't say that now. I'm working. You know, I said, what do you mean I can't say that now I'm working? You know, oh, when we're working, that means time exists. And we're not working, that means it's okay for time then not to exist. And we tend to have a split mind like this where we think, okay, well, I can relax now. I don't have to believe that time is so important. And then when we're working, we think, oh, yeah, time's really important. It really exists. So basically, I'm trying to catch myself. Each situation I go through, I'm trying to say, hey, am I practicing now? Am I practicing? So I've been doing this on the internet, going to various videos and pages, wiki pages, and stuff that's really heavy, really important, really spiritual. And I'm saying, am I still practicing? Oh, yeah, I'm reading the autobiography of this great sage or something. Am I practicing? Oh, yeah, I can practice while I look, you know, read this. So I'm sort of you're sort of dispelling yourself. You're no longer spellbound. You keep practicing to not be spellbound, okay? Not be spellbound by anything. And the better you get at this, the more confidence you have. Say, hey, nothing in this world can hold me. Nothing. What is this world except the collective belief of those that think they need time to solve their problems? That's it. What is this world other than that? It's just a collective projection of time worshippers thinking that they can't get well unless time does it for them. They have to involve time in getting well. That's all it is. Say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And essentially, this is an ascension attitude, ultimately. We hear of the, we don't get into that, but I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. No changes have ever happened. No changes have ever happened. So time, space, process, and form, that dream didn't do anything to change what I am. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay, now, so pragmatically, I'm saying we need, in this world, we need a go-to assertion. This is what my life has shown me in an intense life of a spiritual endeavor. You know, we got tricked. We got tricked by high technology. Because what happened with high technology, even the whole scientific age, you know, the modern high-tech age, which has been going on pretty much, you know, since the, you know, end of World War II, atomic energy, and it's been going on for 60 plus years or so, actually. What happened was we said, hey, there must be an easier way, you know, for us. We seem to be making progress with time here. And there must be, technology is going to make it easy for us. So we don't need to, whatever spiritually works, technology is going to make it a lot easier for us. This is our attitude. This is what crept into us. And attempting to deliver this message as I did back in the 60s when technology was really starting to take root, high technology, we're roaring toward what? Computers. And computers are roaring towards the internet and roaring towards smartphones and, you know, it was all in the pipeline and you could feel it. And so someone comes along and says, hey, you know, forget all this technology. It's not going to make it any easier at all. And it doesn't really, you don't need to make it any easier because it's already easy. Try selling that to a world who was, you know, giddy with anticipation of what science and technology was going to do for them. Couldn't take root. It was like throwing seeds on concrete. Truly, the world was so enamored and giddy with itself and how smart it was and how smart it was becoming. So hopefully now there are plenty of people who are disenamored and the bloom is off the rose at this time. I know for me it most certainly is. The troubles that technology have given me are just legion. Getting worse all the time, and you know the game is up. It's a scam. Technology is really fundamentally a scam. We've really been badly scammed. Its promise is unfulfilled. It is glass beads. You know, say here, turn over your soul for some glass beads. Is what it really is. You know, if I look at my life, is it really better? No. You know. Am I wiser because of technology? No. I would submit that people have become a lot dumber because of technology. Way dumber. I'm just thinking of my relatives, the older folks that have passed on, how smart they were, how capable they were, how just common sense they were, how, you know, and look at the world today and people are just, we've gone in reverse. Actually, technology is a boondoggle. It really is. And so, hopefully there are people who realize that and say, hey, you know, I don't think technology is going to save me. I don't think it's salvation. And then we realize, oh my God, I could have been doing this all along. That's a tough pill to swallow, isn't it? Why didn't I do this all along? Well, because nobody would listen, really. And everybody was just saying, hey, you're stupid. Come along with me into the future, and you won't believe, you know, how easy everything is at that time. I said, yeah, but this is already easy. Just say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. You can't get any easier than that. They said, oh, yeah, whatever you're doing, it's going to be better. It's going to be easier. And it will blow your minds how amazing what the civilization is. And just, wow, you know. Well, we're here now, and it's a big dud. It's a big dud, right? It's a stillbirth, you know. It's nothing there, really. And I think, you know, I would say there are some who are saying, you know what, this is just, technology is just bells and whistles, is all it is. It's just a time waster. It really is a glamorous sort of slick way to waste our time, because what all we need to really do is simply spiritually practice, and we will be freed from this terrible dream of time, space, process, and form, bodies, worlds, being entrapped in thinking that we need to have this body and go process through life in order to get saved or something. We will be free of all that absolute nonsense, insanity, easily, simply, and easily. We've always had the technology. The technology is our own mind. That's, we've always had that technology. And saying, no, you need this technology to help you learn how to use your mind or better, blah, 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 blah. That is nonsense. The ancient peoples use their mind way better than we are right now. There are many who have freed themselves from delusion historically. For in example is Tibet. Many had developed the rainbow body. Many simply vanished into pure light, just vanished. You say, what happened to their body? Their entire body just glowed, got brighter, and just vanished into pure light, into light, disappeared. Sometimes they left their nails and their hair behind, but many times not a trace. They just realize that they're not a body, they're free, and they are this pure light. Many, we're not talking about a few, we're talking maybe throughout history, maybe thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands in Tibet, you know. In India, there have been in China, in ancient areas, there have been many who woke up and say, hey, time has never existed. Process has never existed. Time, space, process, and form is only a dream. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still exactly as God created me. And they, to the point where body just vanished into light. And we think, oh, this is something that back then in those times is common knowledge. And yet here's technology telling us that, you know, no, we need to wait for the next, you know, upgrade on our smartphone. That's what we need to do. You know, it's not the smartphone, it's the dumb phone, folks. It is the dumb phone. The purpose of the smartphone is to dumb us down, actually. That's actually its purpose. We already have the technology, all the technology we need. We have always had this technology, and it is as simple as asserting the truth. That's it. The only technology we need is to assert the truth, okay? But these tech folks, they want us to be enmeshed in an endless cycle of consumerism, lining their pockets so they can pretend that they're lording it over everybody else by being so rich and so successful. All the while hiding the fact from us, we already have the technology we need. We already have it. And as far as this, you know, videotaping and doing this, back then they reached way more people than I'm reaching right now. They had people who would travel constantly and meet thousands and thousands, initiate people into practicing. You know, they're very successful. Don't need this high tech, actually. Now, you know, when in Rome, do as Rome do. So we got it. So I'm trying to make the best of it. But We always have the technology we need. Okay, we don't need these peddlers of gadgets at all. We absolutely do not. Always within us, we have the truth of the matter. And that is, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am still exactly as God created me. I don't need any external help from time, space, process, form, or any materiality that can appear in that dream. I'm still exactly as God created me. Okay, which means there is no such, nothing can touch me, nothing can alter me, nothing can take away my absolute freedom, my total sovereignty, my total power. It's impossible. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is true technology. Okay, this is true technology. This is spiritual technology. So in a world that is obsessed with this faux technology, make sure that you have spiritual technology, that you know how to use it. Okay, that you know how to use spiritual technology. And it's not all this difficult stuff the ego will try to mesh you in. The ego will try to waste your entire life chasing after a bunch of mumbo jumbo, esoteric stuff, blah, blah, blah. And it's really as simple as your assertion. You see, the one thing that is lacking is your own will to assert. Okay, you keep thinking that something has to happen to you. And this is belief in time. So you say, well, I just need to do this formula, this thing, and this thing. That's all magic. All you need to do is assert for yourself that I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is spiritual technology at its very finest. At its very finest, it is very simple. And you may think, well, I won't be a big guru, because only saying little simple thing. The big gurus know the 64,000 lines of Dzogchen, and they know the inner secret, the outer secret, this secret, this secret, this secret. Forget it. Forget all about that, okay? Forget it. And whenever that comes up, just say, hey, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, okay? This is sufficient to banish all of that, okay? And keep in mind that we talk about reincarnation, okay? How about pre-incarnation? How about calling the past pre-incarnations of what we are right now, okay? We keep thinking of some linear time where something has to happen in the world. Nothing has to happen from time, okay? So nothing of the past matters at all, actually, as far as needing it to happen. We didn't ever need anything to happen, and nothing of the future matters either, because we don't need that to happen either. Okay, so don't worry about, 2,000 years of this tradition or 1,500 years of this tradition, all the doesn't matter. Totally inconsequential. Has absolutely no bearing whatsoever on your capacity to realize your freedom right now. There's nothing they ever did that change your situation at all, really, right? See, I am not a body. This is a fact, right? So nobody needs to establish a fact. There's nothing we need to do to establish a fact. God, the Prime Creator, established that fact that we are not a body. Okay. So all those gurus and throughout the whole history of this planet have not done one single thing to establish this fact for you. It's already true for you. It's true for you right now. Without any past or future, it's true for you. Nobody has to do anything to make it true for you. Same thing with I am free. God created us free. There's nothing that any spiritual teaching or guru or tradition has ever done to make you free, to make anyone free. And there's nothing that they ever will do, nothing that will ever happen in the future that will make us free. We're already free. Okay. I am already not a body. I am already free. Okay. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. There is nothing that anyone has ever done or will ever do that will make this true. It's already true. It's already true. It's already true. So do not be intimidated by any of the past or any of the future whatsoever, because there is no one from the past or the future that is doing anything for you or against you that can change the fact of what you are in the slightest bit. You already are that way. I am already not a body. I am already free. I am already still spirit, exactly as God created me. All we need to do is apply our spiritual technology, our assertion, right now, right now. So the ego tricks us into thinking that somehow the teachers of the past, they did something for us. Oh, what do they do for us? I got to figure out what they did for us. Then I got to be part of that process of they removed obstacles for me to that. No, they didn't do anything. This is the point of, you want to talk about radical Dzogchen. This is the point of it. This is the point of the real Ati Yoga, the Maha Yoga, is to realize nothing needs to happen. Nothing needs to happen. It's already that way. But because of our time worshiping, we're afraid to see it that way. And this is the trouble, along with our continuity fear, saying, oh my gosh, that's too good for me. I don't think I can handle that. And so then we keep thinking that something has to happen in the past. We need something to have happened for us in the past. And we have to be part of a process and a tradition and all this kind of stuff. Not true. Not true at all. Which is why the traditions have always kind of been very upset with those who, you know, the immediate enlightenment right now. It's not even immediate enlightenment, it's already enlightenment, actually. If you really want to get even past the sudden enlightenment school of Chinese, what the Chan or whatever it is, the sudden enlightenment, which is sort of, you know, the Ati Yoga talking about sudden enlightenment. Actually, it's not sudden enlightenment, it's already enlightenment. It's already enlightenment. It's already the way everything already is. It's just we're believing in time, is all. That's it. We're still believing in time, thinking that everything we did to ourselves, as far as pretending to be twisted in knots and become form to trick God, we think that time did that. That's what we told ourselves. And not us. We didn't do it to ourselves. So, of course, we think we need time to heal it. So we're terrified of saying there's no time. What do you mean there's no time? We say, of course, so there is. You know. So sudden enlightenment gives what we're going to look at this in a way right now. And we're going to call it already enlightenment. Already enlightenment. I'm already enlightened. Everything's already enlightened. There's not a trace of time anywhere, actually. Never has been. Because sudden is still trying to have at least a backdrop of time, right? Yeah, suddenly, okay, but we're not saying suddenly, we're saying already. I'm already enlightened. Yes, I know I am already enlightened. Now, nobody from the future should give, you know, if they continue on in the worshiping of time, should give 2 cents for anything that we right now are doing for them, so to speak. Because they're already enlightened too. They're already enlightened this instant. They've always already been enlightened. There's never no case other than that whatsoever. Never been any time. What we're doing, what those in the past have done, is point this out to us. So they've been helpful in telling us where to look. Okay, that's fine. But they didn't establish what we're looking at or looking for. No one has, except the Prime Creator God. No one has. So we don't want to drag the past into time, the great teachers of the past, into time, because they realize there's no such thing as time. We're not some later development. No, we're concurrent, always concurrent with them. We've always been concurrent with all the great teachers. They realize there isn't some linear outflowing of time, actually, at all. So they know they've always been concurrent with us. So they're not on some power trip of being better than us, trying to be better. I did it first. First means time. No, there's no first. There's no first. Everyone's already enlightened. They didn't get enlightened. They realize that they're already enlightened. There's no way they cannot be. There's no way they cannot be. Really, enlightenment is a realization. There's no way you cannot be enlightened. It's impossible to not be enlightened. So these teachers, just, you know, when you meet them, they're not like trying to say that they're somehow better than you or anything like that. In my experience, they just hang, it's like, just act normal, like, you're, you know, everything's normal, and you're just my friend, and always have been my friend. And you get this feeling like, you know, huh, that's not what I expected. I thought they would, you know, there's some, you know, prima donna or something up there, and I thought, no, not like that. To do that, they would have to believe in time, wouldn't they? And then they would be deluded. So Jesus always says he walks beside us, always beside us, equal. We're all equally free. We're all equally already enlightened. We're all already enlightened. Impossible to not be so. So ultimately, there's no even reason to even speak of enlightenment. But from our standpoint of trying to, you know, drop our belief in time, it's pragmatic. It makes pragmatic sense to use some terminology. Okay, there's nothing wrong with that. That's fine. But again, to see that there is no time, then we say, uh-oh, well, how do I dispel myself from all these mental entanglements? Through this asserting that I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Using an assertion like this that just cuts right through it. Just goes right through it. Don't need to say anything else. This is all you need to say. I'm not a body, plain and simple. I'm free. Plain and simple. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, plain and simple, and that's it. That's all you need to know. It's just a reminder. That's all we need to remind ourselves of. We're just reminding ourselves of the truth. And then we just ignore these mental entanglements now. We just ignore it, saying, yeah, I know this will just spontaneously just dissolve and smooth out, iron out, because there's no cause for it anymore. I'm realizing is causeless, except for my own mind, and the way to cure that is to, for my mind to assert what is true, you see, instead of trying to assert what is false. So just assert what is true. This is the great secret. Assert what is true. But it's an assertion. It's an assertion. So I went like about 7-8 hours this morning straight asserting this and watching all this clever entanglements come up, and I just kept going and kept going, and the entanglements kept coming up. This is meditation, actually. This is meditation. You want to talk about real meditation? It is asserting the truth and continuing to assert it in the face of all these temptations. You hear, you know, the temptations of Mara, Buddha, you know, Jesus, temptation in the wilderness. All these mental entanglements come up and want to say, hey, if you're so smart, help me solve this entanglement. And you just continue, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And these entanglements are very clever indeed. And I would realize I'm suddenly in one without even knowing it, hardly. You slip into it almost without knowing it. And you suddenly say, whoa, I'm not practicing. I'm trying to figure out this entanglement. There's nothing to figure out except to say it's not a real entanglement at all. It's not caused by some external source, so it's not an entanglement. In other words, the real way to let go of it is instantly. We're free. We're free of it right now. So assert your freedom from entanglement right now. This is the only way. Assert your freedom from entanglement right now. Because if we don't do it right now, we're actually empowering the belief in the entanglement. Okay, and this is why everybody said, no, wait, technology, we want to see what all this technology does, you know. And I said, well, you gotta wait. Yeah, wait 50 years, then we'll see. Well, that just empowers the belief in time, doesn't it? So assert your freedom from entanglement right now. And the way, how do you do that? See, how do you do it? By asserting right now. So he said, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm going to boost something here because it's getting dark. And okay. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. See, you're asserting freedom from entanglement right now. So you're not dragging time into it. Time, the belief in time is the entanglement. It's that simple. Ultimately, the belief in time is the entanglement. No belief in time, no entanglement. Because no matter what the scenario is, if you're free to experience whatever you want, you can shift an entire universe instantly. Say, I want it different. Boom, it's different right now. It's already different. So how can you be entangled in anything, actually, except belief in time? So if you, what we try to do is delay ourselves, so then we bring time into the picture. Say, well, how do I solve this problem here? I say, whoa, wait a minute. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Remembering that it's impossible for spirit to be entangled in anything. Impossible. Absolute freedom. What can absolute freedom be entangled in? That's the question we need to ask ourselves. What can absolute freedom be entangled in? And maybe I'm speaking continuously here and intensely because I don't know when this wireless connection is going to drop out. I want to get it all in. It's so far so good, but I don't know. It's the weirdest thing. But so far so good. That's great. So we can catch our breaths here a little bit. And we're just taking this in. You just take it in. And you just, you know, just consider it. Consider it. Consider it. And it's amazing this fear lock we have of not worshiping time. How do we worship time? Through delay. Delay is how we worship time. And if you look at your life, you'll honestly just say, yeah, I've just been delaying, really. I haven't really got to what I want to get to yet. Why? Well, we say we need to give time a chance, you know, to work on my life. Why are we here as bodies in the first place? Give time a chance to work on our mind, actually. So we have these appearances in this world, so it's set up to give the illusion of time, process, space, form, and to work on these forms, and then by identifying with these forms, think that somehow our mind is being worked on, is being healed. Being, you know, something is changing our mind or something. Once you realize, you know, this is all, you know, a fantasy, that there isn't any time, and therefore I'm not entangled really at all. Don't need bodies anymore. Don't need to appear at all in form like this, in this situation, apparent form, apparent nature, apparent process, etc. No need whatsoever. And this is what the adepts realize. Oh, there isn't any slightest need whatsoever. I know that for absolute fact. And so, poof, just into light, just dissolve into light like that is very possible for us. Even at this time, it is absolutely possible for everybody. Ultimately, absolutely is possible. Didn't they say Jesus began shining brightly, very brightly, so bright nobody could look, you know, went up into the sky, into the clouds of heaven or something. Dissolved into light. Okay, there have been thousands and thousands and thousands in this world do that. And in fact, we can do it too, as a matter of fact. Absolutely, we can do it. Just as well as anyone else can do it. But we're not aiming at anything in particular except to assert the truth right now. This is the key. Assert the truth now. Not tomorrow, not a minute from now. Assert it now. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And it's the assertion of it right now that you feel like, wow, you feel the effect. It's very profound. And it's different than having this time lapse in your mind somehow, like, okay, but I've got to let time at first, you know, put in the context of time in order for, to make sure. It's like we're trying to influence time to be more effective in curing us. That's not real practice. Okay, trying to influence time to be more effective healer of our minds, it's delusion. That is delusion. That's the path that doesn't work. We're not giving time any credence whatsoever here. Say, I already know that I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Yes, I already know that I am already free. Yes, I already know that I am already enlightened. So when you practice continuously, you realize you're practicing right now. You're not letting time into the picture at all. And then you realize that this is real meditation. We oftentimes wait for something to happen. And no, don't wait for anything to happen. Asserting the truth right now is the happening. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. 1, 2, 3. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. 1, 2, 3. Assert it right now. Don't wait for anything to happen. Don't wait for... It's kind of like you say, okay, time, I'm going to say this. Or I'm going to say it. And what we're really trying to do then is we're trying to bluff time, saying, we're saying, time, I know you can heal me, but you just don't want to do it for some reason, but I'm going to force you into it, because I'm going to say this practice, and if you don't heal me, time, right away, I'm going to say this practice. And we try to scare time into healing us. This doesn't work. This doesn't work, of course, but this is what we have been doing, and hoping that time will finally smile upon us, you know. Say, oh yeah, okay, yeah, you're a good one. Okay, I'll let you go. I'll heal your mind, but the rest of them, nah, you know, not so good. We can hold on to them. And it's like that, but no, that this is not the way. That's not the way to practice. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And so we just keep saying this and keep saying it and keep saying it and practice it in different life situations, and you'll find out you forget to do it. And some situations will intimidate you into thinking, no, I can't do it here. I practice it in church, Catholic Mass. I said it during the whole time. No problem at all. But there's some circumstances where, you know, you just kind of go blank. Your mind goes blank because you think that you're supposed to take, you know, supposed to heed what the authority is telling you to heed. You know, the time is talking to you now, and I need to listen to what time has to say, what time, space, process, and form is telling me. So this is the way we do it in order to get healed, and you must do it this way. Oh, your mind goes blank. Okay, I need to remember what to do. What do I do now? You know, just keep saying, in your mind, just keep saying, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Just keep saying it and saying it. And this is, quote unquote, the healing. The healing is ultimately the acceptance that nothing ever happened to you. Nothing ever happened to the mind. That's the real healing. A course, this is astonishing for us. So we need to repeat it over and over and over to let our astonishment gradually, you know, wear off bit by bit. This is the continuity fear, the astonishment of the continuity fear. Like, oh, I mean, this is just like such incredibly great news. I just don't know how to handle this. This is just too much good news, you know. So keep saying it to yourself over and over and over, and gradually get used to this good news, this super great news. Yeah. 1 minute. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now, one advantage of having this mic like this is I can talk real quietly and you can still hear, right? So don't disturb the neighbors. As maybe the neighbors don't want to hear, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. You know, it's like, why? What's that? So you don't need to say it out loud, you know, to the world, just internally in your own mind. Now, of course, we're very wary about this because we don't want to disturb time too much. You know, we think that time will stop being on our side. But keep in mind, how can what doesn't exist, what has never existed or never will, how can that be on our side or for us or against us? So how can it be for us again? Is it? It's our own imagination, our own pretense that is actually doing everything. So when we're willing to say this, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, that's lessening our pretense. It's lessening our pretense. So we don't need to be against ourselves, you know, so much here. Now, you will feel likely some fatigue, some strain in this because we're nervous about it. This is the problem of the spiritual path, is there is strain involved because fear. We're taking these steps and saying, oh my gosh, what's time going to do to me? Time's not going to do anything to you because it doesn't exist. And you say, but I'm so used to believing it exists. How am I going to function? I don't know. And all this nervousness causes us fatigue. There's no question about that. Where's the counter on this? Let me see. Okay, that's the broadcast time, and I think the actual recording time is down here. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Very good. Very good. Very good. Okay. So far so good. So far so good. So far so good. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now, what is important is when you feel these entanglements, launch right into it. When you launch into it purely. Okay, I would say, when you see your mind is struggling with these entanglements and stuff, just remind yourself, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And you're not trying to apply it to anything. You're not like sprinkling salt on anything. You're just directly drinking it. It's not like you're trying to change anything, rearrange anything, apply it to this entanglement, or do anything with the entanglement. It's more like an attention thing. It's like you pull your attention off the entanglement and put your attention upon the, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. You just put your attention on that. This is the secret. Just pull your attention away, even though it feels like it's attracted like a magnet. You know, you got to break away from that. Let me put my attention on, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now you wonder, how did those in the past, you know, who've been here before, done that, how did they succeed? This is how they succeeded, actually, is actually doing this, actually pulling their attention off of the entanglements, back to the assertion, and doing that over and over and over until it got easier and easier and easier. So even the really, you know, severe entanglements, the cleverest ones, they can still do that, and they keep practicing until finally there's no entanglement that really has any juice to it at all anymore. And at some point, they're able to accept the fact that, you know, time has never existed. Nothing's entangled. there aren't any entanglements, actually. And that's why they look upon everybody, smile upon everyone. It's because they realize that you're not entangled. No one's entangled. Nothing is entangled. There are no entanglements with time. Time doesn't exist. And that's why they're just smiling all the time. Everything's perfect, you know. They seem so nice and friendly to you. Hi. They see you, the fact that you are mind, just the same as them, the one mind, and you're not entangled at all. We're just like scaring ourselves, like with dreams, you know, hallucinations, scaring ourselves. It's like, oh, there's this terrible jungle full of snakes there. I've been trapped. I was horrible. It's not there at all. And so one who sees that, they just realize you're perfectly fine. This, everything's perfect before you, actually. You're totally free. You're perfect. And so they rejoice in that fact. They see you. How can they not rejoice that they're seeing someone who's just as perfect and as free as they are? And it's like, wow, I'm so happy to be here with you, you know. And you're saying, what's wrong with them? Why are they so friendly? Why are they so blissful? Why do they treat me so well? You know, like I'm wonderful. I'm not wonderful. I got all these illnesses, these sicknesses, these troubles, and yet they seem to think that I'm perfect, you know. Because you are. Everyone is. Everybody is. Very simple. Simple, simple, simple. It's important to realize that all those who have realized didn't do anything for anyone. Okay, didn't do it. Nothing needs to be done for us. We already are what we are. We're already perfect. They didn't make you perfect. They didn't do anything like that whatsoever. So you don't need to spend time worshiping them or time thanking them or time doing anything for them. Okay, in this way. At all. They didn't accomplish anything for us, so to speak. They just realized, oh, I don't need to do anything. No one needs to do anything. It all is perfect already. The mind has never been trapped. The mind has never been entangled. There's never been anything external to the mind. So they realize nobody needs to do anything. Everything's perfect already. Already perfect. Everyone's already enlightened. So they didn't do anything for it. So you don't have to think, well, yeah, I've got to spend all this time and somehow in relation to that. In my experiences, any of the teachers I've met while my body's sleeping and my consciousness is more receptive to that, they never asked me to worship them or think of them as having done something for me or anything like that. Just the opposite. Yeah, just... It never even came up at all. In fact, Ramana Maharshi said, keep doing exactly what you're doing. It's going to work. He says, it will work. And he says, it works just as good as inquiry. Who am I? He said, as a matter of fact, you know, who am I is not, and Ramana Maharshi did not say that's exclusively what everyone's supposed to do. And that's not true at all. He did not say that. In fact, he said, everybody, you know, there are different types who have different approaches, okay? That many who came to him would be helped by self. So who am I in that type of inquiry? Just who am I? Just do that. You know, this is intensive. This will work. And what Ramana said to me is, keep doing what you're doing. That also is going to work. And he says, it's just as successful. It's fine. It's great. It'll be very helpful. He said, just keep doing it. See, there's no spiritual ego there at all. You know, they're just saying, okay, you know, there are various focuses, ways to pull your attention off entanglements and realize everything's already perfect. All right. But we're not trying to become masters of them all. He said, keep doing what you're doing. Stick with what you're doing. Don't try to do this I am inquiry. Forget it. Just stick with what you're doing. And so, great advice, right? When we find for our times, situations, and the way we are, as far as our how we have structured our delusions, so to speak. When we find that which is works for us, and we know that this is it, this is what works, then just stick with it. This is the advice throughout history: is just stick with it and do it. And of course, the ego loves to have you be a dilettante and go from one to the next. This is something that they sort of misinterpreted Ramakrishna, who did many different paths to show that they were all the same, led to the same realization, which is fine. But there are so many who thought that, oh, okay, this is what I need to do. And I need to, you know, attain enlightenment through this path and this path and this path and this path. You know, but if you really attain enlightenment, would you really be doing that? Is a question, you know, right? I have to ask this question. Because you realize nothing needs to be done at all, actually. And all that we have to do is find a simple assertion that we're willing to accept for us and simply apply it right now. And this is what works. So why do we need to be peddling ecumenical, like, let's try this and this and this and this and this and this? What happens is we become bargainers and shoppers, and you know, and we think we need to do a little of this and a little of that and a little of this and a little, and we never become truly proficient at anything. So that's a very bad side trip, is to think somehow you have to be proficient at everything. That is nonsense. That's like all you have to do is drive your car to the market and there's the food, and you don't have to say, well, I've driven like most of the way and this is pretty, but I want to see if I can drive this other car here too, and this other car here in this truck, and I want to drive every vehicle there is and see if I can also get that close too, you know, get close to that way. And you waste incredible time if you just drive your car to the market and park, get out and go in and get the groceries, you know, go home and get, you got your food. It doesn't matter, ultimately, how we assert the truth, only that we do it and evaporate, you know, the continuity fear that we have. That's it. We're already enlightened. Nothing ever happened. We're already enlightened. Nothing ever happened. We don't need to accomplish anything for us, ourselves, or anyone else. We don't need to show off for anybody. Okay. That's not advisable, actually. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. You can't be any less than anyone else. The idea is, well, I'll be less if I don't use the right mantra or japa or approach. I'm going to be. Is it possible to be less than anyone? There's no such thing as less in reality. There isn't any time entanglement. Is how can you be less? You're still exactly as God created you, and created all spirit as eternally free, perfectly free. So the idea, and pure freedom cannot be entangled in anything. So the idea of greater and less is impossible in reality. It's impossible. And all we have to do is realize that, yeah, there's never been any entanglement. And we realize our freedom. So we're not, there's not greater or less there at all. When we're trying to be greater, we're really trying to be less. We're trying to bring time into the picture and say, well, I can't be completely healed yet. I gotta get some help from time. So the idea that you can be, you know, more or less, it brings time into the picture and saying, well, yeah, I need to work, you know, I gotta still do a lot of work for many years, this with this, and I gotta work with this, and I gotta work with this. All the while we could be asserting, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Okay, all the while we could be doing this. So this is the message of, you know, radical Dzogchen Longchenpa, for instance. This is basically the message they have different ways of getting the message through, but this is the message we're giving here. This is the message of Jesus Christ right now too, is I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me right now. I've always been, this has always been the case, right now. I'm already enlightened. I'm already not a body. I'm already free. I'm already still spirit, exactly as God created me. There's nothing that establishes this. There's nothing that needs to protect it. Okay, you don't need to defeat time. Time doesn't exist. Nothing has to be defeated. There's no foe of reality. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And the ego say, yeah, well, there's other things that'll work too, you know, and sure, fine. And let those who the Holy Spirit guides to other assertions, let them do that. Holy Spirit has guided us to this assertion, let us do that. Okay? Very simple. And the ego says, yeah, well, yeah, this might work, but what about something else? Maybe let me help you. Maybe that needs to work too. And the ego pretends to help you. Say, yeah, great. The ego says, hey, why don't you work on a bunch of other ways too? And, you know, I said, no thanks, ego. That's a trick. Saying that I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So you will be intrigued by the tricks of the ego, but don't try to catalog them or name them or describe them. So just go right back to, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, because you do not want to go into the future of this world, so to speak, the various events that are arising here, being easily distracted. Someone there, I don't know, being easily distracted by these tricks of the ego. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. That's the truth. That's it. Nothing more than that. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Nothing has changed. Not one iota has ever changed. I'm still absolutely the same as I've always been. I'm still absolutely free. And there's no way in the world I could ever be a body. Impossible. Freedom is always free. You can never define freedom at all. Reality is indefinable. Undefinable in either way. It can't be defined. Absolute freedom can never be defined at all. And we think that time is the great definer, that time has managed to define. This is not true. We are just pretending that we've been defined. We are pretending we have, this is the power, creative power of the mind. We're pretending that we have been defined. So we're pretending that we're a body. We're pretending that there's this world here. You know, we made a world. We're pretending we made this universe. We're pretending time, space, process, and form. But none of that is actually defined at all. It's not a set definition. It's a pretense where we can then infer, plausibly infer, oh, there's this force called time that's actually doing the defining, you see, defining God. Actually, thereby making God lesser, you see, lesser. And then we think, oh, you see, God, we made you lesser. We must be therefore greater. And it's just a little game we're playing, a silly little game that we're playing. And you know, we're playing our little, imagining our little sandbox, and God's not fooled at all. God's just telling us, hey, it's just a little silly game. That's it. And helps us out. So, the spiritual romance of the past is something that the ego promotes because it delays us, okay? And so we get caught up in the romance of the spiritual past of all these lineages and the depths and teachers and all these wonderful, wow, you know, all these incredible secret teachings and everything. And we can get caught up in this romance our whole lives. And it ultimately boils down to you simply asserting the fact that I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay, that's it. That's it. And so at some point, you have to drop that romance with all of that. Now, a figure from the past did show up while my body was, sleeping, inert, and my consciousness was alert and awake in a dream. A figure from the past, someone who was an adept, who had realized that they were already enlightened. And they showed up here, okay? But they did not bring any trappings of the past with them, none of the romance of the past with them. They didn't put on any airs or anything like, hey, I'm some big wig from some, radical Zogtran tradition, and you need to know the lineage, you need to know this, you need none of that. None of it. Same thing with Jesus showing up. Didn't bring any of that up at all. Not at all. In fact, Jesus did say something in A Course in Miracles about formal religion. He says that doesn't help you at all, actually. He's not a fan of that at all. His own words say that. Because it's way simpler than that. Remember that most of our practice is under delusion of trying to influence time so that then time can influence us properly. We think that time's the boss, that time has defined what we are, and therefore we want time to give us a better definition of what we are. Okay. So we're doing all these esoteric exercises and everything, but deep down, it's largely we're trying to influence time, which is ultimately magic. Trying to say, time, if you don't redefine me in a way I like, I'm really going to cause you troubles. I got the power to make you redefine me, time. I'm going to, trying to influence time to redefine us. But that's not the way reality cannot be defined. Pure freedom, absolute freedom cannot be defined. There is no power of definition that can define us at all. So spending our time trying to influence something to define us in a way that we like better, this is wasting our time. We're being tricked. I mean, we're tricking ourselves because of our continuity fear, really, is what I say. Is why do we do this? Why do we waste time? Because we're afraid the good news is just like too good, I think, what? I'm free. I'm not entrapped at all. When you think you've been buried under a trillion tons of rock salt, and then you realize that you've never been buried at all. This is a big difference, right? As far as what you're experiencing is. And so, at first it's like we feel like, well, let me just make a little room here in this little cavern here in the rock salt. So I'm still buried, but I've got a little room around me. This is fine. This is fine. So this is a continuity fear. We're not quite ready to realize our absolute freedom. So we kind of feel a little more spacious and not quite as entrapped. So we keep changing our definition of our situation. But this also enables troubles to seep into us too. Okay. So it's not a very smooth path because we're still believing in time. And definite that there's something that can define us. So we're still paranoid. We're still frightened. We're very much so. We're saying, "Oh, I finally got time to do something good for me. Great, but what if it? What if I get time gets mad at me, or what if somebody else gets mad at me and they're going to define me in some way I don't like?" And so you're still walking on eggshells, really. And therefore, you walk on eggshells. You got to overcompensate. You got to work so hard. I got to try and somehow make the world definitions go my way, make definitions go my way. And it's frightening. So you don't have that effortless bliss that those who realize it all is already enlightened, they have this effortless bliss. They're not working on it at all. And my experience with Jesus is like this, is he wasn't working on anything. His mind was just naturally perfectly calm, perfectly peaceful. All was this way. He's just totally relaxed, calm, peaceful. Not at the mercy of any definition, you see. not fearing that at all. So this is the way that we can be too. And so it's better to keep trying to go at it more directly like this and work as much as we can at this. And keep hearing this more quote-unquote direct approach. Even if it seems difficult, the alternative is not so good at all, actually. Because you easily get into definitional battles with people then. Spiritual intellectualism battles with people. Well, you call it this, I call it this. You're afraid, still afraid of definition, walking on eggshells. So if you can just try to practice and say, hey, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And see if you can say that for like an hour or so. You know, just prove it to yourself. Just challenge yourself like that. And as you get better, you'll challenge yourself more and more. I challenged myself today. And I did, you know, for like 8 hours or so, just terrific. Just fantastic. And then I kind of said, wow. And I've kind of kept going, but not just intensely. So keep challenging yourself to do this. Keep challenging. And then you will, the better you get at this, the wiser you become automatically, because you see, hey, I can do this. Whereas the ego, the whole thing is telling you, oh gee, I'm so sorry, you can't do that, you're not able to do that, so let me offer you this commiseration, you know, this other way is so difficult and different. But when you realize I can do this, then you know it's a different story. You say, wow, I don't need to pay attention to all these entanglements at all. I can just go right past them. I don't need the time to, just my attention. I can keep my attention off of this stuff and say, I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And I can keep my attention on that. And this is what we have to prove to ourselves, that we can keep our attention on the truth. Because we think that somehow our attention is being controlled by time through definition. It's actually being controlled. And so we have to keep proving to ourselves it's not being controlled. It's only our own lack of habit, our laziness, our fear, continuity fear, that makes us, our attention go back to entanglements. But there's nothing actually external to us that is controlling our attention in any way. But how do you know this until you prove it to yourself? You see, you can't just take someone's word for it, because it seems so plausible that there is that. And so if you just have to practice and prove to yourself there isn't any such force at all, we're only pretending there's some force. So we are very good at pretending that we're being controlled by forces. This is our cleverness. This is our genius, our imagination, our creativity is being used to pretend that we are being controlled by forces. And in fact, we are not. Not by any whatsoever. There aren't any. But we won't know that for sure until we prove it to ourselves. You cannot merely take the word of someone else. If that were the case, then there'd be someone who realizes we're already enlightened, just says the word, and everybody, that's it. That was the key. No, we have to prove it to ourselves. We have to come to conviction within us so that our attention does relax, actually. Ultimately, it's told our attention simply relaxes. And we realize we don't need to put our attention anywhere because it's already where it needs to be. So ultimately, the attention truly relaxes, but we won't get to that true relaxation of our attention unless we first assert the fact that we are not influenced by anything whatsoever. I am not a body. As long as we believe that we're a body, we will not relax our attention. As long as we believe that we're not free, we will not relax our attention. As long as we believe that we are, have we been changed, we're not still spirit exactly the way God created us, we will not relax our attention. We'll be too frightened to. So, but what I say is this practicing, this is what I intuitively feel, is we'll automatically reach the point where we just automatically relax our attention. And then people will say, hey, you're enlightened. And you say, wow, yeah, everyone's already enlightened. It's just that our attention is so freaked out, it cannot really, it's not realizing this, okay? This is how I see it intuitively. I feel this is so. And so don't try to force relaxing your attention. It never works that way if you try to force it. So just practice, and eventually I feel our attention will relax. It will relax of its own accord. Just say, oh, I don't need to worry about any definition at all. And then you're ultimately, that's freedom, realizing that this, you're already this free. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is the preliminary groundwork you do for ultimately the relaxation of our attention. Jesus says, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. That's very nice. That's very true. But how do we do that? And I say, practicing this way, it gets us there. Because we still hold on to the thought that I am not a body. That's still a thought. I am free is still a thought. I am still spirit, exactly the way God created me. That's still a thought. It's still a concept. But we hold on to these few concepts. And we say, I don't need any of the others. Don't need any of the others. And once we realize we don't need any of the others, then it becomes very easy to spontaneously, I believe, we will relax out of these concepts and say, just be a spontaneous relaxation. So who's right? Gradual school, sudden school? Both, of course. The relaxation, the idea of sudden school, is it's a spontaneous relaxation. Oh, yes, it is. It resolves itself spontaneously into pure relaxation of attention. But getting to that spontaneous resolution, we certainly need to prove to ourselves that this is the case, that nothing needs to be done with these entanglements, and that time doesn't exist. We have to prove to ourselves that we can accept this. And that takes practice, which means gradualism. The problem is that gradualism can take on a momentum all of its own. So what gradualism does is it can keep on trying to get better and better definitions from time, so to speak. It still believes that it can get a better definition from, at some point you have to set that aside and say, okay, I'm through even working with time at all. And take that leap of faith and say, no, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. You no longer are working with time at all. And this is the radical step, the leap of faith. They would call it radical Dzogchen. He would call it Jesus' leap of faith. And this is the more direct approach. So at some point, you have to do that. You cannot keep on bringing time into the picture, even in a positive way. So this is the direct approach to sudden enlightenment, which is the spontaneous relaxation of attention. See, where you're no longer trying to focus your propitiation or on anything, your definition, anything. You're not saying, I need to focus on time. I need my attention on time to make a better definition. Or not even, I need to focus on a practice to get free of the belief in definition. Now the mind is relaxed and realizes I never needed, to do any of this, really. Okay. So, but I looked, I was able to get a glimpse. It's spontaneous. It resolves of itself. So we just have to keep on doing our work here, our direct work, which doesn't bring time into the picture anymore, but says, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And thank God that the wireless connection is working here, because we're getting in some good taping here. Absolutely. The more we hear this, it seeps into us. But the real step is to actually, right now, practice right now. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And keep saying it. In other words, you're not waiting to see what time's reaction is to this. Say, okay, what is time going to now? What kind of definition is time going to give me? It's out of the picture now. We're not concerned about definitions anymore of what we are, really. We're doing the final defining for ourselves. Okay, we're not using time. We're not trying to appease time, worship time, influence time. We are taking this in mind and saying, okay, I'll make the final definition of what I am. I'll say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'll do the final defining for myself. And from that point in doing this, I believe this, then there'll be a spontaneous relaxing of the attention. It's at some point, I don't know when, but this is something that is I feel will happen based on the just overall understanding of path and what's going on, etc. I said, yeah. So I say, there's reasonable to believe that this will happen. So we do the final definition, not trying to influence anything. See, it's not a definition trying to influence anything. We're asserting it that this is it. I am not a body. There's no deal making, no influence making. I am not a body. I am free. Again, I'm not. If I'm free, there's nothing I need to make a deal with, right? I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. In other words, I'm exactly the same as I've always been. No deals have been ever been made. I don't need to make any deals. So I'm simply defining myself as that I've always been the way that I've always been. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Don't need to talk to time, to the ego, about this at all. Don't drag him into it at all. Just ignore it. Just say, I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And continue and continue, and don't, say, oh, I need to wait. Wait, what's time going to do now? What's time going to do for me? How's it going to go? This is irreversible, so to speak. It's irreversible. There's nothing that time can do at this point. It's irreversible. It's too late for time. Bring that up. It's too late for time. At this point, it's too late for time. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now, when you say this, try and say it at least three times. Three, four, five, times at least. Don't just say it once. That brings time into the picture. Say it at least three or four times, so you realize you mean business. You mean business here. You're not giving time any chance to respond. So if you just loop it continuously, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. You loop it like this. You loop it. And there's no place in there for the time at all. Is there no responses? Don't wait for any responses, feedback, or anything. You just keep looping it. This is the most powerful technique. Now, the looping doesn't have to be precisely, you know, it's just continuous. Be continuous. And try to be continuous for a while. This is, you know, I've been practicing on this, and you can get, surprise yourself, actually. Ultimately, surprise yourself that, yeah, I can do it I can keep doing this, actually. And you may get a little tired and kind of slack off a little, but then you can come back and do it some more. And that's all I do. I try to do the best I can. I don't keep track of how long did I loop it or how many loops. Don't try to count at all. Forget about counting. Nobody's keeping track of counting this or that. Just try to do as much as you can. Do the best you can. I only say, well, I did about 8 hours. But during that time, I was looping sometimes. I was, you know, pretty steady a lot of the time. Some of the times I was not quite as steady, but I was still trying. I felt like I was really in the ballpark as far as making a great effort as it goes, but I wasn't keeping track of exactly how long I'm looping, not looking at my watch or anything like that. No, I just realized I woke up about 5 a.m. It's now like about 1 p.m. in the afternoon, and I'm still kind of getting tired. So, okay, I was at it for about 8 hours or so. But generally, I'm pretty very, very ballparkish about stuff. Don't ever get into trying to nitpick, you know, exactly how many times, exactly how long, exactly this, exactly that. Try to be kind of relaxed about that. Don't worry about it. That's not really important. Because, you know, you'll just get better at it as you go along, that's all. And there's nothing that I know of that says, you know, you have to do this amount or that amount or et cetera. It's just doing it and getting better at it and continuing to do it and getting better at it and just being consistent. Keep at it. Keep at it. And again, we're going towards the spontaneous resolution. So don't worry about the goal either. Don't worry about the goal. Automatically, when we shut time out like this, there's going to be a spontaneous resolution. Automatically. So the secret, the trick is to shut time out. Shut it out. Pitch a shutout. That's that dream I had where I finished. I the game was over. As a couple days ago, I had this dream. And what was the secret? I pitched a shutout. I shut time out. And when you shut time out long enough, spontaneously the game's over. And some your tension relaxes spontaneously. So we are in a very good situation, actually. Don't let time tell you otherwise. Don't let time bargain. Oh, okay, I'll redefine you. You don't need to. I'm not worried. I don't need to be redefined. Time. I don't need to be redefined. I'll take care of my own definition. And I'll say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. There you go. Good enough definition right there. And keep saying, just shut time out entirely. Shut it out. And you will have a very interesting time because you're actually really meditating now. And this is a wow. When you realize you're really meditating, you don't take a backseat to anybody historically, okay? Nor do you take a backseat to anyone in the future. No backseat, you're in the front seat now. And of course, this is this wow. I've been trying to help us with this wow. Like, wow, I'm in the front seat. And now I'm driving. Wow. I'm the one who's now driving. Wow. So for sure, there's these wows that you need to relax and accept. You know, when we do this, we're not second fiddle to anybody who's ever practiced anything anywhere, in any tradition. Not second fiddle at all. We're truly meditating in a way that is profoundly effective, and that's all you need to do. That doesn't take a backseat to anyone. And there's no need to compare more than that. It's just that this is not a backseat. This is not insignificant in the slightest bit. This is getting it done right here, right now, which is the only place you can get it done, which is shut out the definitions from time. Shut it out. Shut them out. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And just keep doing this and you get more and more used to it and it gets easier. This is what I find now for me is like, hey, I can, you know, it's getting easier and easier and easier. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And I'm starting to recognize, you know, this, yeah, that's right. This is right. This is it. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. No other definitions. See, you don't go into any other definitions. You just don't even entertain them. Something comes up, they say, hey, how about entertaining this? I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. End of story. And, of course, there'll be many peddlers that come your way. And you just say, oh, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And you just go right past those peddlers. And again, it is the greatest show on earth. When you're actually really meditating like this, because of how clever the peddlers are, you'll just kind of say, wow, that's a tricky peddler. That was a tricky peddler. And you leave, as you leave them in your dust, you know, that's a tricky peddler. That was a tricky peddler for sure. It's like, holy cow. Our minds are very clever. You know, it was just to say, wow. And don't bother trying to explain it to anybody. It's too clever for words, really. the approaches that the mind will take for you, oh man. So you'll get a kick out of that for sure. And you say, I had no idea I was so clever and smart. Yeah, wow. The mind. I had no idea the mind was so clever and smart. It's so slick. You know, absolutely so slick. And it is, before you know it, it's like you're, whoops, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And continue. And before you know it, that slickness is just vanished. It's gone. It's vanished without a trace. And the next one is ready to get you. And then you just dismiss that one too, and that one too, and you do the best you can, and it's kind of fun, actually. It's kind of fun. Especially when you realize that you're succeeding. I said, wow, I just dismissed that one. Holy cow. That's about a 10-year delay I just dismissed right there. You know, just walk right past it. Just kept saying, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. You just keep saying it, and just keep saying it, and that's it. And they may say, you got a one-track mind. You say, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Actually, reality is all one. Reality is one track. That's it. Our minds are one track, which is what? Absolute freedom. There isn't any other way. So, of course, definitions of what we are, the final definition is that there are no definitions ultimately. It will be one track. Of course, it's say, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And we're still here, and we're still recording. That is great. I couldn't get this to go directly to YouTube from Ustream. I used to be able to do that easily, and it was like, so it's super easy, but now I have to download it to my computer and then upload it to YouTube. So I hope it just goes directly across and processes. I don't know. Is you have to work around these bugs, don't you? Absolutely. But here we are, here we are, here we are. Spiritual tech, applying the real deal, real spiritual tech here. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. We're doing the definition, not time anymore. We're in the driver's seat here. Cooling off here. As the sun has gone down and has gotten dark now. So we rest a little bit in the wow. We try not, you know, try not to slouch. We just keep ourselves in a reasonable position of assertion. It's kind of hard to assert when you're completely slouched. Now, of course, when you're lying in bed, that's a different story. Your body language at that point doesn't matter because you're like pretty, like almost half asleep. I find actually that is the most interesting time because you're kind of alternating. You're in a half asleep condition. You're alternating with your sort of dreams. Your mind easily slips into a dream state, and then you easily see that suddenly you're dreaming this fantastically ridiculous dream, and whoa, you say, whoa, wait a minute, I'm not a body, and you snap out of it like that, and you see how easy your mind just drifts into this, you know, a fantasy, a delusional fantasy, so easy. That's when it can get really interesting. I tend to wake up early in the morning and then just practice for hours. And that can be quite amazing. And of course, then your postures is not supporting. You just lie still and don't even think about your body at all. You're just focused on the mind and the content of the mind. You're not thinking of needing to do anything or being interrupted or anything. You're just quietly there paying attention. What's my mind? What kind of story is my mind spinning now? Whoops, whoa. Okay, back to practice. And, of course, don't worry about, well, how did I go from practicing into this cuckoo scenario? Don't get caught up into the how. just go right back to practice. Say, whoops, okay, just drifted off. I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And just keep doing and keep doing and keep doing until you drift off again. And then you realize, whoops, I drifted off again. And then just go right back to it. Do not get tricked into analyzing how you drifted away. Then the ego has you. Okay. Well, you just drifted away because of habit. Okay, habit, that's all. Just all. Okay, drifted away, habit. Go back now. That's it. Because really the drifting away was probably you start analyzing something, right? Started thinking instead of practicing. As soon as you started thinking, then you started drifting away. So just go back. The cure for thinking is not more thinking, it's going back to practicing. Which is bringing our attention to the final definition, taking all definition away from time, putting all definition consciously with mind so that we can then finally relax our attention into no definition. See, this is the intermediate step. Very tired today. The effort I'm putting in is extreme, so of course I'm tired. This is my lot in life, is to put up with this tiredness. Very funny, because my previous life to this, or you can say my pre-incarnation to this one, I had seemed to have inexhaustible energy. I was never tired. And people would always marvel and say, how can you just always, be able to be focused and intense and you know, never tired, never wear out. It's incredible. It's like some Superman or something. And now, is this one still recording? Yeah, it had a little blip right there. In this life, I've always been extremely fatigued and tired. Complete opposite. So I just, just take naps and try to deal with it. It's weird, but it does. There is a pushing this hard. There is a fatigue to it for sure. So take a nap when you need to. Take a nap. By all means, take a nap. Don't be too proud to take a nap. I know if you're young, you don't want to take naps. When I was young, I could never take a nap. In fact, it wasn't until I was almost 50, before I could take naps. Prior to that, I could never take a nap. And there's a lot of people that can't take naps. Now I'm very good at it. I just say, I got to. Otherwise, I'm going to die. So I just got to take a nap. But when you're young, it can be difficult because you think you're supposed to be doing stuff and you're losing time, valuable time. But keep in mind that by doing this fourth phase practice here, you're very close to spontaneous sudden enlightenment of relaxing your attention. You're very close to it. So that, you should take a nap when you're tired. It's not like by doing this exercise, you're going to be doing it for 30 years. It's just, no, not at all. Not at all. When you shut time out like this, that's curtains for time. And you don't give it any oxygen. It's quickly comes to an end, so to speak. So don't feel bad at all if you're young or at any age where you take some time to nap. Because this is strenuous. It's spiritually strenuous. It's a strain because you're not used to shutting time out like this. And I believe that this is a problem for young people, is they feel ashamed that they get tired and need to rest, and then they take stimulants, like, very stimulants to keep themselves going so they don't rest, and then ultimately it burns them out and they get depressed. And then they go antidepressants. And this is something I've been warning about and telling people about, is, take a rest. If people saw me resting, from a previous life, they're saying, now I spend this time napping, they'd say, wow, never thought that, So if I can do it, anyone can do it. If I can do it, anyone can do it. If it's okay for me, it's okay for anyone. You know, you don't, if you know, you don't have to be this awesome dynamo, okay? Trying to impress time to redefine you, okay? That's all it is. Say, hey, time, say, time, I don't care how you define me, time doesn't matter. I'm defining what I am now, and that's the final definition. I have the final say. I have the final say, and I'm going to take some rest here because this is a strenuous effort. If you get your rest, you take your nap. I mean, for instance, I got up today, and there was no work. I don't have any work, and so I waited around for a while, and then I just felt so tired. I just decided to go lie in the bed and just rest some more. I rested like for another hour and a half or so, but I was practicing on and off the whole time. But I did fall asleep and got some rest. So in other words, I got out in the morning, and then I decided I was still tired, and I just decided I need to sleep some more and took some more rest. So whenever you can get some rest, take some rest. Whenever you can get some rest, take some rest. Whenever you can get some rest, take some rest. Even if it's a half an hour. Like before I went to church last Sunday, I was tired, I felt tired, and I just decided, I'm going to just try to lie down and see if I, and we, you know, I like fell asleep for about 15 minutes. I only had like a half an hour, 15 minutes or so. Helped out a lot. Help me practice this. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me in church. I was able to do that while we were singing all the whole time I was able to do it. Make good use of that church time like that. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And sometimes it'll take 3, 4, 5, 10 times of saying this before you start actually, your attention starts focusing in on it. And other times during the day, you're so busy, you may just be saying it, but you're not really focused in on it. That's fine. Keep saying it. It's having an effect. You're grooving your mind, as it were. And so it becomes such a habit, it's easy to go back to. It's like that song that's always playing in your mind. You can't get out of your mind. Well, this is a new song in your mind. This is the song you want playing in your mind. This is the song you want playing in your mind. You want this song playing in your mind continuously. So it's always there. Oh yeah, I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Keep playing that song in your mind. Groove it in there, just like we listen to some songs hundreds and hundreds of times, looping it, and that song just gets burned into our mind, doesn't it? Well, we keep burn this into our mind. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Burn that in. Burn it 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 in. And then even when times get crazy, as they will in this world, it's right there. It's always there. It's always there. It's always there. And you can keep practicing, and you'll get even better and better and better at it. And then at some point, your attention will spontaneously relax. At some point, for those who actually do this, not everybody will actually do it, unfortunately, because they're still intimidated by time too much. They're still, the whole situation seems a little too frightening. It's understandable, sure. But there are some who can do it, and some who will do it. And for those, their attention will at some point spontaneously relax. And then they'll be a great help for others, actually. Great help. Subtle thing. It's a subtle thing. Because some people just say, you know what? I'm not alone in this. So I'm going to start doing this. I'm going to start shutting out time, too. I'm going to be the ace. I'm going to be the ace. I'm going to pitch the shutout here. That's one of the things I want to do in life. I want to be a pitcher, be an ace, you know, Hall of Fame pitcher, and just throw shutouts all the time. But now, it didn't happen, but now I'm throwing a shutout against time You see, that's the biggest opponent. That's the biggest stage is when you're pitching against time. Throw a shutout against time. Then you know you've got good stuff, really good stuff. And the stuff is easy, you know, fastball, change, curveball. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. You know, 1, 2, 3, that's your stuff. Just 1, 2, 3, strike three, you're out. And just go right through time's lineup. Send them right back to the bench. Strike them all out. Easy. You know, don't show any mercy to time, because time will never show any mercy to you. That is for sure. The belief in time will never be merciful to us. So I am not a body. Strike one. I am free. Strike two. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Strike three. Back to the bench. Grab some pine meat. You're done. And you get all these hitters come up to the plate, you know, and they're doing all this pre-bat routine, you know. Twirling the bat, you know, pounding the bat down, patting their helmet, you know, and flexing their muscles and taking practice swings, you know, just like, you know, they're like trying to intimidate you, right? They're doing all this stuff like they're so confident, you know. And don't even pay any attention to that. Just say, hey, you know, I am not a body. Strike one, I am free. Strike two, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Strike three, you're out. So, you know, don't even think about, what are they doing? What is this what are they trying? No, they're going to do all sorts of circus acts up there. You know, the mind will throw these circus acts up towards you, bring them up to the plate and say, who's this joker now? You know, they'll just incredible stuff. It doesn't matter. Say, you know, you're already out. You're already out. Yeah, you can't hit this. You're already out. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. You know, sigh, that's it. Sight is out, you know, next inning. And you just go through them like a hot knife through butter. You're just, you know, mowing them down like you're the lawnmower. You're the hammer, the lawnmower. Just, poof, you know, cutting that grass and that's it. And you see, they can't hit you. They cannot hit that. When you do it, practice this way, they can't hit you. Time cannot hit you. You're winning. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay. Now, sometimes you'll feel it better than others. Sometimes you'll feel like, that's okay. Don't worry. You'll be saying it again and again and again. So if it's not always, if you don't always feel like totally assertive, that's fine. Because you'll be saying it again and you'll feel better at some other point when you're saying it. You'll feel it at some point. Beautiful. I always like to watch great pitchers, baseball pitchers, pitch a complete game shutout. They just said no mercy. I mean, they just finished it. You know, they finished it. You don't see that very often anymore, actually. But in their mind, you see, they're not losing. Period. So they've already won the game in their mind. That's it. And you know, there's no let up. There's no let up. This is their job. This is what they're doing. This is what they're going to succeed at. It's plain and simple. That's it. So, you know, we're like that. We're like the ace who's just saying, we're the ace pitcher, and we're saying, this is it. It's curtains. It's finished. I'm just going to, you know, mow the lawn right now. Got the lawnmower. I'm going to mow the lawn. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay? And you just keep bringing that stuff and see what happens to the batters. And you'll find out that they go back to the bench with the tail between their legs. They don't have a chance. And you don't need to pay any attention to them. They know they're whipped. They're whipped. Yeah, can't hit, can't touch this. Can't touch this. No, can't touch this. So don't fool around. When you're out there and it's the seventh game of the World Series, you don't fool around. There's no time for fooling around. We're in the seventh game of the World Series. You know, bring in the ace. You know, bring in the ace. Don't fool around. Don't fool around with fancy stuff. And no, just bring the 1-2-3. What, you know, bring the unhittable stuff with you. Break out the unhittable stuff. It's time for that. You know, no time to get cute when it's the seventh game of the World Series. No time to get cute. Do what works. Do what works. There's no wiggle room. And as a world, we're in the seventh game of the World Series, so to speak, as a world right now. So we can't fool around with cute stuff at this point. Cannot. Not, can't get away with it. If we can't fool around and get away with it, no way. No, we will pay the price. So we're bringing the unhittable stuff here. We're not trying to make friends with time anymore. That time has passed. It's gone. Still recording. Beautiful. Beautiful. The last video, I thought it went over 3 minutes, but I was looking at the total elapsed time, which is first you hit broadcast and then you hit record. So I was looking at the total broadcast time that I've been broadcasting, and went over 3 minutes, but the 3 hours. The actual recording time was like 2 minutes, 2 hours and 57 seconds. So I didn't go over the 3 hour mark, as I thought that maybe they'd change the software, but no. Maybe they have, but I kind of doubt it. See, 3 hours is about the average length of a major league game, isn't it? 3 hours and 2 minutes, something like that. They want to speed up the game these days. They want to put in clocks now between innings, and then batters can't step out of the box and all this kind of nonsense. And it's like, ah, gosh, leave the clocks out of baseball, please. Leave the clocks out of baseball. You know, let the players kind of, let the umpires, you know, regulate themselves. Let them know that these are the things we need to do, and then let them do it. They'll take care of it. Don't actually need a clock. They put clocks on the wall, you know, 30 seconds, gotta do this, gotta do this, gotta do this. Ah, that ruins the charm of the game, you know. Leave time out of the game. Leave time out of it. You see, when they start bringing time into baseball, you know they're bringing time into everything. Right? I mean, baseball is the final oasis where there's no time. I remember in the playoffs last year, the Giants against the Nationals, game went 18 innings. It was maybe the most epic game I've ever seen. I listened to the 24 inning game, whatever, with, I don't know, what was it? What was the game? No, it wasn't 24. I listened to that one too long, but then there's also another one that went a long time. I listened to Juan Marichal and Warren Spahn that lasted a long, long time. Both pitchers pitched the whole game. That might have been like 18 innings too, or 16 or something. I don't remember. Anyway, this game was epic. Absolutely epic. 18 innings. It was incredible. It was just like the best game you've ever seen. Everything was on the line. It was such an important game. At any moment, you know, any little thing could happen and that would be it. And it just went on and on and on and on. And it was fantastic. Loved it. Everybody was just texting and saying, "This, can you believe this? Can you believe this? This is, oh my gosh." You know, there was no clock. There's no clock on, just, you know, it was like midnight there, and then it went into the morning, to early morning time, and it was going to play it all night pretty much. They'd suspend it at some point. There's like some curfew, maybe 2 in the morning or something. I don't know. But they're going to keep going and keep playing it until finally there's a result. No clock, no time. Just let it go. Just let it keep going and end. So when they put a clock in the baseball, that's it. You know, that's the final. You go to a baseball game to escape time. You listen to a baseball game to escape time. There's no limit to how long an inning can go. You know, it can go an hour. There's no limit to how many runs you can score. There's no limit to how long the game can go, or short. Sometimes the game's over really quickly. Maybe under 2 hours, or it could go fast, pretty fast too. There's no limit. So you feel like you've kind of escaped time a little bit. Kind of like golf that way too. You know, golf is supposedly untimed. And, you know, it can take an hour, can 6 hour round, whatever. However long it takes you is how long it takes you. So, but now, here come the clocks. Here come the, well, you start thinking, oh, I hope they're not going to take too long. I hope they, terrible, terrible idea. And the reason why they're doing it, the commissioner said, plain and simple, is because they want the game to appeal to younger people. They're losing the younger demographic. Why? The commissioner also said, plain and simple, they have a shorter attention span. Baseball has tested all this out. They're very aware. And they have found that younger people have much shorter attention spans. Even 20-year-olds. Because why? This is a different generation, different video games, texting, you know, click, 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 click. They want stuff to be quick, 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 quick. And so they're saying they can't stand watching a baseball game. It they can't do it. And so they're losing their younger demographics. And they say, oh my gosh, we can't compete with, you know, games that are bam, 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 bam. The clock, 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 clock is there. Everybody wants to have that clock winding down on them. And so they're losing the younger generation. And so they're messing with the game and trying to speed it up for the younger people. Meanwhile, it's changes for the older people, you know, who already have been supporting it for so long. And this is the problem with the world, is that we're bringing time, more and more time, more and more time into this world. As more and more short attention spans come into this world, more and more time worshippers come into this world who are frantically playing with definition faster and faster and faster. See, playing with definition, trying to influence time faster, 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 speed it up, let's speed it up, like that, in this way. To get more change, to get more change, to get more change, to get more happening, thinking they'll get lucky or something, right? There's a huge problem. Global problem. It's not like it's just the U.S. It's all young people all over the world have shorter attention spans. They've been all been brought up, by and large, on technology for the most part. But it's a global thing, global problem. This is what we're up against. We're up a younger demographic. Keep in mind that over half of the world is what, under 32 years of age. I looked up my age, and what was it, like 80? I'm older than what, 83 or 87%, sometimes maybe 83% of the world is younger than I am. 83% of the world. Most of the world is under the age of 32, which means most of the world, let's see, if they were born in 1980, they'd be 34, right? 35 at this point. So let's say 1982, 33, 83. So most of the people, majority of the people in the world were born after, you know, 1983 or later, which means they've grown up with computers, with high technology. 83 by the time they're 10 to 93, and you know, they've grown up with all of this stuff. That's all they know. That's all they know. Tension span, ding, 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 you know, like this. Over half the world is already this way. And they're the ones that are being marketed to by advertisers. They're the demographic. Now they try to set lifelong consumer trends, lifelong loyalty, lifelong conditioning to respond to advertising and respond to pressure to buy this, pressure. Okay, so this is the culture, consumer culture. These are the people that count to them. So older people don't count anymore. They don't care what happens to us, really. Not so much. Not really. We've already made most of our major purchases, right? Yeah. So they're after the younger ones. And so frankly, they don't really care about older people. And if they say 83% of the world is younger than you are, what do we care about you? So you don't really have a voice, actually, in today's world. Don't really have a voice. Except spiritually. You don't really have a say except spiritually. And you do have a say over your own destiny. That's really all you have a say over right now, especially the older people. It's all you have a say over is your destiny. And you can be the driver of your destiny. Okay, you can be the driver of your destiny. And I'm sharing how to do that. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is taking charge of your destiny. This is having a voice in your destiny. You're the driver of your destiny. You're the one driving the car of destiny. Okay. You can do that. This is something every one of us can actually do. And so we've trumped the cosmic corporate culture, haven't we? We've trumped them. Okay, they cannot defeat us. They cannot make us irrelevant. They cannot determine our destiny for us. Okay, they cannot. We already have the technology, superior technology. And this is the assertions, phase four assertions here. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay. This is spiritual technology. We all already have it. It doesn't cost anything. You can use it, and not a penny does it cost you for actually doing it in your mind, right? And you can do it at all times, constantly, during any situation that arises in the world. Nobody can stop you from doing this. So we are not defeated after all. Not at all. Not at all. Just not at all. We're totally in charge of our destiny, actually. Cosmic corporate culture has not taken our destiny out of our hands and placed it in their hands. We are still driving our own car of destiny, our own vehicle of destiny. We are not irrelevant to ourselves, are we? Not at all. So, I'm not a body. I am free. I am spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. This is our destiny. We're stepping into our destiny. We're accepting our destiny. And in doing so, inherently, we shed this cosmic corporate culture destiny, which is trying to condition us to keep playing with time and trying to influence time and believing that we're definable and we just have to keep, you know, defining our ways in this way and ourselves in this way and this way. Oh, here I need to buy this, so now I have a different self-image. Oh, let me get this, I got a new self-image. I got a new self-image. Let me put this makeup on and get a makeover. Oh, I've got a new self-image now. I've a new self-image, new self-image, new self-image. Buy, 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 buy. Like this. Waste your time, waste your time, waste your time. Suffer, 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 die, die, die. Take all these pills, 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 pills to see if you can continue on a little longer, spend a little more effort in changing self-image this way and that way and this way and that way, the way they tell you that you can change your self-image. And see, this is all the path of spinning your wheels, continuing in misery. So, we get free of that false destiny. Just listening to the traffic in the background, the freeway in the background there, distantly, just sort of a white noise hum. Get used to it. And then when you go out in the boondocks and there's Chris, it's completely quiet, you just say, "Whoa, it's too quiet. Where's the white noise?" Yeah, you don't realize it until you just are quiet. You can hear the vibration and of the freeway in the distance. Absolutely, because there's so much traffic on it. It's still rush hour, so you've got just packed traffic. How far away is it from here? A couple miles, probably. Actually, a little less than that. That's in the ballpark. Yeah, I would say a couple miles. It's not that far. Under 2 miles away is there's this freeway. Now, they did kind of depress it down, and they didn't elevate it. They did the opposite. They depressed it down and dug sort of like a trench. So it's down, you know, deeper than ground level, the freeway. It's below ground level by about maybe 30 feet or more. So that supposedly helps with the noise. You're supposed to plant trees and stuff, but, you know, we don't really have the water for that here anymore. And that kind of didn't plant ivy in the walls. It kind of muffles so it doesn't bounce off the walls. They build walls too, cinder block walls and stuff, but the ivy doesn't really, you know, and I didn't follow through with it so much because cost in water. Now, I've seen some new freeways in LA. That new one to Pasadena, I think I drove on it when they were still working on it, and it just opened, and the landscaping on that freeway is unbelievable. It was like you're driving through a park. The both huge banks on both sides were absolutely landscaped like you would not believe. I mean, it was the most incredible freeway I've ever seen. The landscaping was just, every inch of it was landscaped beautifully. I said, "What is this?" But well, right now I'm thinking, well, how in the world are they going to keep watering all these landscape freeways? That takes a ton of water. I said, "Uh-oh." Don't be taking any of our water, LA, to water the landscaping on your freeways. You know, you got to let that go. And your swimming pools, by the way. No, you can't keep your swimming pools going in this kind of drought. Absolutely not. But everybody still is. Everybody still has got their swimming pools, you know. Wow. We are headed to the apocalypse here, folks, in California. You want to know what the apocalypse, where it hits first, is? It's hitting right here in California, actually. Because there isn't any more rain. I mean, we have like some showers coming in, like a couple days, maybe like two hundredths of an inch. Next week we might have like 0.05 of an inch, or maybe 1/10 of an inch of rain, or something like that. And this does nothing. Does nothing. And we're already going close. We'll be into March, and March and April, you know, pretty much it. I mean, rarely. Sometimes you can. At one time, it did rain in May a lot. Okay, so it's possible, but it's also historically likely that March, April, you know, we're pretty much finished with heavy precipitation. Possibly in March we can get something, but it's quite possible we're finished with our precipitation in California. And if that is the case, people will be drinking their swimming pools, you know. They'll be showering in their swimming pools. I mean, we're talking about apocalypse here. I don't even know what's going to happen. We may be showering with bottled water, actually. Yards are just going to, you know, we don't have the water. you know, it's I don't know. Farming will be probably curtailed to an extraordinary extent, quite possible, in order to divert the water to people. So I think the first to be hit will be the farmers. The whole ag business in California is on a cliff right now. There'll have to be federal assistance for the economy, and the economy is just going to, you know, take a devastating, devastating blow. So the apocalypse is, you know, coming likely this summer in California. And, you know, it's easy for us to just ignore it for a while, but no, it's on its way. They showed the snowpack. No snowpack, really. Had to cancel the ski events up there, Squaw Valley, Tahoe, Lake Tahoe. No snow. Not enough snow to run in it. No way. So there's no runoff. You know, there's not many runoff. We don't have any runoff during the spring and summer to fill the reservoirs to keep. No runoff. Groundwater's already. We're so far down in the groundwater that, you know, if you keep doing that, it could cause dire circumstances. The reservoirs are very low. Those will be, you know, go empty at some point. Where do you get the water? This is a question. Don't have it. So nobody's saying anything yet, right? They're all praying for rain, thinking, well, maybe it'll come. I say, like, I don't like the way it's looking. I don't like the way it's looking. Even if we got some heavy rain in March, it still wouldn't be enough at all. You see, this is the problem. We would need like a deluge, you know, to hit California to make a difference. We would need like 25 inches, to, you know, in the next couple months. And historically, there's no way that's going to happen. So apocalypse is coming to California. So that's one of the reasons that I feel I got to, you know, I've got to do this. We can't wait here in California. Yeah, living right here, it's not earthquakes we're worried about anymore. I mean, that's going to happen too. But it is drought. And the severe, severe mental problems that is going to bring to people of this state. We are simply mentally not capable. We think we live in paradise, and most people in this state act like this is paradise, and they landscape their yards, and they act like this, I found nirvana here. And so when they're told there is no water for any of your plants or your lawn or anything like that, this is going to fry their minds. I guarantee you. This happened once before. We had to let our yard die. And I remember I had this lawn that was like the best lawn you've ever seen, Tiff Green, Bermuda. It was like a carpet. It was just lovely. It was emerald green. It was like impossible to mow it. I didn't have a power mower. It couldn't push mower, so it was so thick you couldn't even mow it. But it was a jewel. This is my pride and joy in life at that time. I was very ill at that time, but this is my pride and joy. I had to let that die, the whole thing die, and never came back. And we had to let all our plants die. It was terrible. I got just very depressed over that. Because here in California, these plants are friends. Our landscaping, our yard is our friend. This is our friend. We love it. You know, this is our beauty. This is beautiful here. We have this beautiful state, beautiful weather. And so to watch that all die, it just tears us up. People won't do it. I mean, they'll keep their plants alive at all costs. And they'll keep their lawns alive at all costs. I mean, I can't imagine what's going to happen when everyone has to let their lawns die. Because this is like a status thing. This is super important to people. And of course, gardeners will not have, well, not much work at all, right? And that's going to make a massive unemployment problem, which could lead to crime problem. I mean, it just goes on and on and on and on and on, the apocalypse that could strike here. You think everything's fine here? It's not. We have a very, very tony suburb area here in the San Francisco Bay Area. The police in San Jose's lost half their police force recently through resignation, people resigning, going somewhere else, or quitting, taking early retirement. Why? Because they lowered the pensions. They had a super good pension program. They said, we can't, this is not feasible, fiscally feasible. We have to lower the pensions. They said, forget it. We'll go to some other city somewhere else and we'll get a better pension there. And they just left in droves, like 100 a year or some more, and quit. So San Jose now is severely depleted with their police force. So there's this really rich suburb area of San Jose where everybody thinks it's the safest place in the world, and it has been for a long time. Crime has gone up there 800%, 800% in the last couple of years. Home invasions, car breaking in the car, because there's no police. Police now only respond to life-threatening situations, that's it. If you're being burglarized, they won't even respond to it. You know, it has to be life-threatening for them to even respond because there's so few police. So imagine with massive amount of people out of work, ag business, no more agricultural jobs, gardening jobs, all this, what are people going to do? Yeah, what are they going to do? They're going to try to get whatever they need to get is what they're going to do. So the Golden State is not so golden, folks. That is putting it mildly. Well, what do the people in that suburb do? They've hired their own private security forces. This is literally what they had to do. The community had to go in, you know, somehow I don't know how they got money for it, but somehow, and then hire private security. So if you can afford to hire private security, that's what's going to happen. You're going to need it. You're going to need it. So yeah, the Golden State is about to become not so golden in a big hurry. And we're right in the middle of this. So we need our own Golden State, don't we? Which is what? The spontaneous relaxation of our attention off of all definition. And realize there's no need to define what we are at all. The Prime Creator has already defined what we are, which is perfect. Perfect freedom. Perfect freedom. Perfect safety, perfect sovereignty. We're already defined by God this way, and we can never change that definition. So we don't need to. We can relax our attention off of definition entirely. This is the real Golden State that we need. This is the cure for the apocalypse. Okay, so I'm right here in ground zero of the apocalypse here, actually. We have a ton of California has a ton of people who are on the margins. And when this snowball thing, drought, is going to affect those people on the margins real fast. And, you know, those people are going to do what they need to do to survive. And they're going to start feeding off of others, okay? They're going to start, it's not going to be pretty. And it's not something anyone's looking forward to, as a matter of fact. And, so, the peace of mind of Californians is threatened, to say the least. We're so spoiled here. The people here are so spoiled. I mean, when you tell that the old couple there in the corner, you know, they have a rich life, the whole life and everything, the way that, you know, gone their way, and you got to let your whole yard die. And by the way, you know, somebody just broke into your house and stole everything. I mean, what's their mind going to be like? You know, well, they're going to take anxieties. You know, they're going to start pharmaceuticals. I mean, you talk about a gold mine. For the pharmaceutical companies, California coming up, people are going to be suffering from severe mental illness all over the state. Spend their money on pills. Try to cut their anxiety down. Can't blame them, you know. Can't blame them. It's sad, but sort of precursor for the world in a lot of ways of. You know, just this, some point, you know, stuff builds up to the point where we just feel like, whoa, I need to lessen it somehow. Because I feel like the wheels are coming off. You know, it builds up and it creeps up on us. It creeps up on us like a snake. That's why time worshiping is often depicted as a serpent or a snake, because it creeps up on us and afflicts us in ways we don't expect. We keep thinking everything's okay. My definition of myself is fine. My self-concept and everything. And before you know it, you're in the doctor's office or psychiatrist's office. And man, I can't sleep. I can't shut my mind off. I'm a mess. Oh, okay. We got something here. Here's a prescription for you. Go down and take that and try this. You'll probably feel pretty worse for about a month or two, but eventually you'll feel a little better. And say, okay. You start having these vivid dreams, things weird, and you realize that my life's a mess. I'm depressed, I'm suffering from all sorts, and then, you know, things, wheels come off this way and that way. This is how time worshiping works. This is what happens. Gets the best of us. Got me, you see. I'm sure it's gotten a lot of those viewing this video, as you understand, it got you too, right? So what do we need to do? We need to throw a shutout against time. We need to shut time out. Throw a shutout. How do you do that? This is what we're hearing about and practicing now. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Strike one, strike two, strike three. See ya. Right? And also, there's some other techniques that we have. I already know that this situation is already exactly the way I really want it to be. In other words, everything is half as cup. The cup is half full no matter what, which also shuts out time, right? You're not asking time to define anything for you, because everything is actually included in the pure non-definitional matrix of reality already. You see, it's already included in it. There's nothing outside. There's nothing being influenced by outside. There's nothing defining anything for you that is exterior to your mind. This is already the case. So you can practice in that way too. I'll do videos. I've already done some on that. And help you with this. Yes, I already know. That everything is already exactly the way I really want it to be. Very potent practice. So practice, 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 practice. And I especially advise those who are in ground zero spots around the world to take this very seriously and practice. Those of you in California, take it very seriously. Those of you, there's other hot spots around the world too, right? Ultimately, the whole world's a hot spot, actually. There may be some who think that, oh yeah, we've got it made in the shade here. Well, don't be so sure about that. So practice, practice, practice. Already be an ace. You know, this is spring training for you. Spring training's just started now in baseball. So get in shape. Get in shape so when the season starts, you're ready to go. So when the season of discontent in this world starts, you're already an ace, and you're gonna you can pitch a shutout against time. Even to the point where your attention relaxes, and then the whole world appears differently to you. The entire world, everything appears to be radiantly perfect. Which we can't even imagine or describe at this point. We don't need to. Ultimately, we will spontaneously relax our attention into that. And it won't be a problem for us. But yeah, that's the real panacea. That's the ultimate panacea. That's the real panacea. And don't think that you're ever going to hear this from cosmic corporate culture and its massive corporations of one of the most powerful of all is the pharmaceutical cabal, of course, who, that's the last thing they want you to know about, right? Ultimately, it puts them out of business, right? So they want to be sure that you don't know about it, right? Okay, but you're in charge of your own destiny, ultimately. You're in charge of your own destiny, so nobody can stop you from practicing. Nobody can stop you from practicing. Nobody can do anything to you. Nobody can define what you are. Okay. In order to do anything to you, they'd have to define what you are. You'd have to accept that definition of what you are. But you're indefinable, actually. Cannot be defined. Nobody can do anything to you, actually. So, in the meantime, we do the best we can. Say, I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And see if you can feel some positivity about this. Like, hey, this is great. This is wonderful news. Wonderful news I'm telling myself here. Wow, I'm not a body, I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. You know, this is fantastic news. This is the gospel, meaning the good news. So try to see it that way. Eventually you'll start feeling that way. Getting a little cool out here for sure. But we're rolling right along here, rolling right along. So try to be aware that pressure is on everyone in this world, and take it seriously, and don't get caught up in trying to say, well, what exactly is going to happen? Well, whatever it is happens, there's going to be a lot of pressure on everyone's minds, and you're going to respond in one of two ways of that. You're either going to get more mentally ill and take drugs and stuff, or you're going to get mentally well, one of the two. One thing's for sure, when the pressure gets severe enough, you know, you get off the fence. You know, the frog either jumps out of the pot or gets boiled. One of the two. Keep turning the heat up. You know, you say, whoa, this is too hot. I'm going to get out of this pot. It's too hot. Or you get boiled. So what we're going toward is perfect mental health, actually. What we're aiming for is perfect mental health. All right, that's what we deserve. That's what we already have, actually. We just have a dream that we have something other than that. But we already do have perfect mental health. We just need to accept this fact. And it's a great time to accept the fact we have perfect mental health. It's a great time for that. It's a wonderful time for that. The world is set up for that, because the alternative is not at all pleasing to us, not at all. Perfect mental health. I already have it. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. There you go. There's a new practice for us right here. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I'm already perfectly mentally healthy. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I have perfect mental health. Very nice exercise that the Holy Spirit has just released for us, you know. Just, hey, here it is. It's just right here. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that it's a little cool out here, but I have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Believe it. You see, start believing this. And then it's when you start feeling the wow. Wow, how fortunate I am. Yes, indeed. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Wow, wonderful. Now, those who want to continue to pretend otherwise, well, what are they doing? They're worshiping time. What are they doing in worshiping time? Trying to sacrifice something of themselves to time so they can claim then that time, look, time, I've sacrificed something precious that I have to you, time. So can you please, in return, give me a better definition of what I am? Right? Vicarious atonement, vicarious sacrifice. Look, look at this sacrifice we've given you, time. Please define us in a better way now, time. So what are they going to do? You know, they're going to suffer, right? And that suffering is designed to get time to be a little more accommodating to their self-image, their self-concept. This is just going around in circles. Okay. This is not mental health. it's mental sickness. Is basically saying, you know, can you at least help me, you know, define my suffering is not so bad, my suffering is not so terrible. Can you at least, you know, I want to keep my self-image, I want to keep all my mental illness, but can you take the suffering, ease the suffering up a little bit, please, time? Yeah, you're a beggar to time, you're begging time. A slave to time, begging time. Say, look, time, I'll die for you. Really bad, I'll die, but please, you know, give me a little better self-concept. That's mental sickness. But of course, yes, I already know I'm already mental. I already have perfect mental health. In fact, yes, I already know that everybody already has perfect mental health. This is a fact. Yes, I already know that everybody is already perfectly mentally healthy. Okay, yes, I already know that everybody already has perfect mental health. There are just some who are pretending otherwise, that's all. And of course, you can't stop anyone from pretending. The mind is free. We're all free. So if some want to pretend otherwise, you can't stop them from doing that. But you can stop yourself from doing that, for sure. And we must do that. We don't want to fool around anymore with trying to appease time somewhat through sacrificing what we, you know, sacrificing ourselves, trying to imagine we can do that. So yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. I'm trying to get a little warmth here. It's getting mighty cold. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. Yes, I already know that I already have perfect mental health. I've been battling a long-running, cold-like respiratory situation, so getting chilled is not the best thing for me, actually. But, hey, it's go time, you know, spring training. You know, we got to get this done. There's no time to wait. There's no time to wait. I've been given indications that something around the time when we get locked into the orbit of Cirrus, the Dawn Explorer, which is what, March 5th or so, something like that, which is, I don't know, what is today, 23rd or something, but 24th, I don't know what today is. It's the 24th, I guess. 9 days away. There's something to do timing-wise with this close encounter with Cirrus, the dwarf planet Cirrus. Ceres, if you want, Ceres. And there's something to do with that timing-wise. There's no question about it. This was pointed out to me years ago, and you know, they're likely to discover it's a water planet. Likely discovers a water planet, and the likely discover it's got more fresh water on it than all the fresh water on this entire planet. But you know, what does that have to do with anything? I don't know. But I was shown something that sort of clued me into this, and so I would not be surprised at all if. You know, intensity ratchets up very quickly, you know, very quickly, starting in March. But I'm not going to worry about it, because I got a practice here that dispels everything. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. You see, and that just figures fly through any clouds with that. This is a plane that quote unquote takes us to heaven, as far as heavenly what? Peace of mind, perfect mental health, actually. This is the realization of perfect mental health. Right? I'm not a body. Great mental health there, right? I'm free. Wow. Unbeatable mental health. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Perfect mental health. Perfect. It couldn't be any better, right? No problems. No problems. No mental health there. No mental health issues there. That is for sure. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me, which means perfect. So, perfect mental health. Absolutely. There have been prophecies of California breaking off into the ocean, very stuff like that. Well, if they pump all the groundwater out of the Central Valley, you start thinking, worrying about it, you know? It's like, I don't know. It's kind of weird. You could get ocean water, you know, seeping into that empty reservoir, the Central Valley, actually. And once you get ocean water in there, you know, that's a problem. There's a problem. I think there's some people scratching their heads right now. The late great state of California. Yeah. That's okay. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Wow. So ultimately, the conditions on this old planet Earth don't have anything to do with me whatsoever, actually. I'm not a body. I'm free. Still spirit exactly as God created me. But those who want to keep worshiping time, they're going to be scratching their heads. That is for sure. And that's why the younger generation, they're all hyped up, thinking, we can fix everything. We can fix, we're going to fix everything. Don't worry, we'll fix everything. We'll fix everything. We got technology. We'll fix everything. Yeah. Well, you know, they'll do all sorts of stuff, try all sorts of stuff. Maybe it's good to be older than 83% of the world right now, actually. Maybe that's a good thing, right? Maybe that's a great thing, great thing. I remember my uncle telling me, he says, I know what's coming to this world, in California in particular, but I know what's coming. There's no question about it. He says, and I don't want anything to do with it. Thank you, I'm out of here. He says, no way, no way. Well, the writing has been on the wall. Now you get a stupid greed. Time worshipping, ultimately, is time worshipping is where the troubles all reside. So, fortunately, we have the technology to deal with it, right? We're the ones that actually have the technology to deal with the world's problems, and that is by saying, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And this is the way to deal with it. This is the technology to deal with it, where we get to the point where our minds will relax, spontaneously relax. Don't try to make your mind relax. Don't try to make your... I've never tried to make my mind relax. That is not the way. That's not going to work. Just remove the blocks, so to speak, so that it allows it to spontaneously relax. And then we'll see. We'll see. We'll see. We'll see. Ultimately, you can manifest water at that point, actually. You can manifest anything. It's going to slow down. What's it say? Please save recording soon. Okay. I think it's supposed to... Nearing recording limit. Please save recording soon. Well, it's supposed to automatically give me a... okay, but I'll... Okay, I will say it's time to bring this to an end. So thank you so much for joining us here. And we have the technology, don't we? We do. All right? So be of good cheer. All right? And we will continue to be awesome. Very great. That's it for this one.